So let's begin. First, a little business. Those who have difficulty getting onto course spaces, just please see me after class and we'll take your email to ensure that you're signed up to be able to get the syllabus and the PowerPoint presentations that are posted there. Secondly, a YouTube channel has now been created with these videos available from the lectures so that you can have them to be able to access at your leisure. We'll eventually find better ways to correlate them with the course space site as well so that you have that information available again to help you throughout the course. Are there any questions before we begin of a business sort of nature? Okay, so what we've been doing is talking about governance under different regimes in Canadian law. So we talked about governance that flows from Aboriginal people's own legal traditions prior to the arrival of Europeans and others, and how that is a source of law and continues to be a source of law in Canada. We also looked at how the formation of early relationships between Indigenous peoples and settlers, both individuals and the Crown, created governance obligations for recognizing Aboriginal people's place to be able to make their own decisions, as a second point. As a third point, we saw the formalization of those governance relationships in treaties, and the Siwi case and the Chippewa the Sarnia case identify those relationships as early constitutional obligations. And we saw in the Campbell case that through section 35.1 of the Constitution, which is the fourth source of law, governance can also be recognized both in its inherent form and also in its treaty form. So governance flows from different sources: Indigenous peoples' law, the relationality through almost like a customary formation, through treaties, and through constitutional recognition. And what we're going to be doing today is carrying this story forward, not so much focusing on governance, although this will be a part of the conversation, but focusing on Aboriginal rights more generally. And we're going to be doing two things today. First of all, talking about the leading up to the entrenchment of Section 35.1, recognition of Aboriginal treaty rights through the patriation of the Constitution. And then secondly, we'll be looking at the first case to be able to interpret Aboriginal rights, which is the Sparrow case, first case to be able to interpret Aboriginal rights under Section 35.1 of the Constitution. So just to take off this first point then, in terms of a constitutional odyssey, it's important to recognize that when we're interpreting the Constitution, that we remember that there are many sources to give life to our interpretive ventures. Right? Obviously, one of those sources is what's in the written text of the various Constitution Acts, which isn't just the Constitution Act 1867 or the Constitution Act 1982. There's all of the acts that admitted various provinces to the Union, like with British Columbia or Newfoundland. There's also what's something called the Natural Resources Transfer Agreement of the 1930s, which is a constitutional document which contains references to Aboriginal people's rights and the Crown's obligations to those rights. So one source of Aboriginal and treaty rights in Canada obviously is the text, remembering the text is more than just the two documents that we're most familiar with. There's something like 30 different texts that you can reference that are formally a part of the Constitution. Another thing though to keep in mind is, in keeping with what I was talking about a moment ago, that there are many unwritten sources to the Constitution. And in fact, section, the preamble of the British North America Act 1867 says that the Constitution of Canada is similar to in principle to that of Great Britain, which means that the Constitution is also written based on an oral tradition as the Quebec Secession reference phrased it, an historic lineage that stretches back through the generations that can give rise to constitutional obligations and be part of the very structure of our understanding of how it is that we're put together as peoples. There's an 800-year-old oral tradition that comes from Great Britain that is formally embedded in the conventions of our Constitution that give meaning to how we are to govern ourselves. And that 800-year-old tradition that comes from Great Britain is mingled with that older 400-year-old tradition where settlers, crown, trading companies interacted with Aboriginal peoples and also gave rise to our Constitution. So it's very, very important to see the breadth of the foundation and the basis for what our relationships would be with one another in Canada, constitutionally speaking. Then in Confederation came along, 1867, you have the Constitution Act 1867, which recognizes under Section 9124 that the federal government has obligations or can legislate in relationship to Indians and lands reserved for Indians. So what you get there is a favoring of centralized legislative power as opposed to local legislative power. Now, you remember when we talked about the Royal Proclamation, the Indians were promised that local governments and local settlers would not be given the opportunity or responsibility for dealing with Indians. And remember, that was a constitutional check and balance? Because if local people were given that authority, the fear was they would molest and disturb Indians. Why? Because if land is going to be alienated or shared by the Indians to the settlers, it's those that are most proximate, the settlers most proximate to the Indians would be the ones that would enjoy the advantage of that deal. And so there's great incentives there on the part of the settler population, on the part of the local governments, to be able to get this land. And those incentives can sometimes be perverse and lead to sharp dealing. So the Royal Proclamation created a check and a balance, which is the most distant government that has a relationship with Indians should be the one that has the legislative responsibility in regard to Indians. And so, in other words, Section 9124 of the Constitution Act 1867 carries on the constitutional tradition of the Royal Proclamation of 1763. Furthermore, you'll remember in 1867 when the Constitution was passed, it was an act of the Parliament of Great Britain. And sovereignty, in some respects, in some great respects, in terms of how the settling populations here viewed it, still by and large resided in London, in Westminster. And it wasn't until 1931 that a declaration, the Statute of Westminster, was given that allowed Canada to control its own constitutional affairs. So the early days of Canada, in terms of the way Indians, Inuit, Métis people would have looked at that relationship, they would have seen Britain still as part of where the authority lie, although, you know, Section 9124 of the Constitution delegated administration of that responsibility to the federal government. But they, that is the Indians, very much regarded that as a delegation of authority, not the creation of an independent source of authority. And so through the time of 1867 up until 1968, as we talked about last week with the white paper, whenever constitutional amendments were discussed between non-native peoples, there was a great suspicion that could take hold amongst native populations, wondering why they should involve themselves often with the Canadian state and, quite frankly, worried about greater incorporation with the Canadian state because, as you saw last Monday, there were so many restrictions on an Indigenous way of life that Parliament enacted. The Haudenosaunee continued to view themselves as being allies of the Crown in Great Britain, not subjects of the Queen or Parliament in Canada. There were no treaties that were signed out in this part of the world by and large. We have the 14 Douglas Treaties. We have the Numbered Treaty, number 8, in the northeast portion of the province of British Columbia in the late 1890s. But other than that, no treaties in British Columbia. They're still waiting for the Royal Proclamation to be given some life. And then on the prairies, as the treaties were signed, they were signed with Her Majesty. And the view by many First Nations people was that we have a nation-to-nation relationship, not with Ottawa, but with that distant power, as the proclamation puts forward, that distant power, the Queen and right of Great Britain. And so whenever there was talk of constitutional power growing in the Canadian sphere, in the Canadian government, Indigenous peoples often worried that this would be a breach of Britain's international obligations to Indians if somehow the First Nations, Inuit, Métis people were to be incorporated in Canada. In other words, they didn't want to see their relationship domesticated. They wanted to see it continually grow on that proclamation footing or that nation-to-nation footing. And so when constitutional discussions between 1968 and 1981 started to become more prominent, again, Indians were very suspicious of this, Métis, Inuit, very suspicious of this, and often took action to resist that occurring. At the same time as that resistance was there, there were many other peoples within First Nations, Métis, and Inuit populations that were intrigued and said, well, if there is going to be constitutionalization, there has to be steps taken to deal with the self-determination of Indigenous peoples in Canada. Early on, there was a Victoria Charter that was put forward in 1971 that looks a little bit like the Bill of Rights that the Diefenbaker government passed in the 1960s. Looks a little bit like eventually what we're going to get in 1982. There's some rights provisions. There's three Supreme Court justices need to be from Quebec. There's provisions dealing with the length of time for Parliament, etc. But there was no discussion of Indian issues in there. And for many Indigenous peoples, they were quite happy about that. And for other Indigenous peoples, they said, wait a second, you're purporting to amend how we govern ourselves and you're not taking account of us. We need to have further dialogue, further discussion to talk about how we will be represented in that sphere. So then in 1981, the constitutional dialogue becomes more significant. You get Trudeau proposing a package of amendments that would be sent to Great Britain for ratification so that we would have our own patriation formula, no longer have to go to Great Britain to be able to amend our constitution. And as a part of this, there were back and forth volleys as to whether or not Aboriginal and treaty rights should be included in this document. Sometimes they were in, sometimes they were out. And again, there was a lot of opposition amongst Aboriginal peoples, as even to domesticate this document and tradition. So in 1980, you get what's called the Constitutional Express, where the Union of British Columbia Indian Chiefs organizes two trains to go across the country to Ottawa to proclaim what their opposition is to patriation, and also to talk about if there is going to be patriation, what the conditions for that might be. When they arrive in Ottawa, I think it was about 500 on the train, it eventually gathers to 1,000. They're met with thousands of other people at Parliament Hill, and they make a petition to Parliament. And then some of them proceed on to New York and make a petition to the United Nations. And then some of them cross the ocean and make a further petition to Great Britain, to Her Majesty. The petition to the United Nations sounds like this. Requesting urgent action by the United Nations Secretary General to prevent the imminent breaches of international law and human rights implemented by the governments of Britain and Canada against the Indigenous peoples of Canada. They felt, these people making this declaration, felt that the patriation of the Constitution, which would either include Aboriginal rights or not include Aboriginal rights, depending on it, could be a breach of international law and human rights. And they talk about the history that I just given you that surrounds the Royal Proclamation, and they talk about their dispossession in this land. They say the government of Canada was entrusted with the administration of Great Britain's obligation to the Indian nations through Section 9124 of the BNA Act, an act of the Parliament of Great Britain. Canada has not fulfilled its trust obligations towards the Indian nations. Rather, the government of Canada has for years expropriated our lands and resources, illegally settled our land, and systematically tried to assimilate our people, undermining the authority of our Indian governments. It's actually a 10-page document. I just have two pages here. It's quite a lengthy recitation of why there was a concern. They go to Great Britain. They seek an audience with Queen Victoria. They make this petition. The Indian nations of Canada submit this petition to Her Majesty, asking that Her Majesty may graciously bring to the attention of the Parliament of the United Kingdom our most serious objection to the proposals of the Government of Canada to amend the Constitution without due regard having been given to our rightful place in the Canadian Confederation. We urge Her Majesty to refuse patriation of the Canadian Constitution until agreement is reached between Canada, the United Kingdom, and Indian nations, which will embody in the Constitution those essential obligations, undertakings, and agreements which the British Crown solemnly caused to be made with the Indian nations in Canada, both the proclamation as well as the treaties themselves, and those conditions necessary to enable Indian nations to achieve self-determination within the Canadian Federation. These petitions, the proclamation before Parliament of Canada, Parliament of Great Britain, Her Majesty, and the United Nations did not get the satisfaction that was desired. And so the chiefs of many of the nations across the country filed a petition for an injunction in the Court of Appeal of England. And Lord Denning, who is the master of the rules there, sympathetically heard the case. The Indians were saying that, as that petition declares, that a patriation of the Constitution without dealing with the Indian right to self-determination would violate British law, not just Canadian law, British law, not just international law, British law. And then you see in the text the response by Lord Denning. It's on page 95 of the materials, which is the Crown, this is after Confederation, was no longer single and divisible. It was separate and divisible for each self-governing dominion or province or territory. Thus, the obligations in which the Crown bound itself in the Royal Proclamation of 1763 are now to be confined to the territories to which they related and binding on the Crown only, in respect of those territories. None of them is any longer binding on the Crown in respect of the United Kingdom. In other words, Lord Denning said, we don't have any jurisdiction to be able to hear your petition for this injunction because now it's the Crown in right of Canada that has authority. And again, this was something that disturbed many Indian nations. They felt it was a derogation of that longer set of promises that had been sacredly embedded in treaties, was found in the Royal Proclamation. So there was all sorts of back and forth in that period in relationship to these strategies. In fact, the main Aboriginal organization, the National Indian Brotherhood, at the last minute was not participating in the, at least formally, in the patriation of the Constitution, because their member nations said, we're boycotting this. Take us out of this. We don't agree to the Constitution coming home. And so, to the extent that they were represented, it was often through back channels, or it was through the other Indigenous organizations like the Native Council of Canada, the Métis National Council, Inuit constitutional groups. Kind of ironic now, standing all of these years later, over 30 years later, when there's so much focus given to Section 35(1) of the Constitution as a possibility for reconciling Aboriginal rights with and treaty rights with the rights of other people, because for many people, just having that discussion, many Indian people, just having that discussion on the basis of 35(1) is a loss. It sets the discussion and the framework in a forum that they never wanted it to occur within. So the very thing we're studying for many people is complicit in a colonial venture that's a violation of human rights, that's contrary to international law, that's contrary to treaty. We need to remember that with each and every case that we study in terms of what would occur. Of course, you do get the constitutional entrenchment in 1982. There were some last minute changes. At one point, the constitutional provision said, the Aboriginal and treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada are hereby recognized and affirmed. It was at the insistence of the Three Prairie provinces, particularly Saskatchewan and Alberta, that the word existing was thrown into Section 35(1). The existing Aboriginal and treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada are hereby recognized and affirmed. Why was that an important action as far as the Prairie premiers thought? It's because they thought as of 1982, there were no more Aboriginal or treaty rights found in Canada. And therefore, by saying existing, that would mean that Section 35(1) would become what's called an empty box. There would be no content to fill in, no rights that could be recognized and affirmed, because nothing was existing as of that date. It had all been extinguished in one form or another. And those that were supportive of the Constitution would say, no, it's not an empty box, it's a full box. Everything that we've ever had survives as existing and therefore could be recognized and affirmed under this this language. So that entrenchment occurred in a very tortured way, without unanimity in any stretch of the imagination in terms of the way Aboriginal peoples think about Section 35(1). For some, it was a cause for celebration. For others, it was a day of deep sadness. There was put into the Constitution not just Section 35, but also a Section 37, which would be 1 year after the proclamation of the Constitution, there would be a series of three constitutional conferences to be able to discuss what the content of Section 35(1) was, to negotiate the meaning of existing Aboriginal treaty rights, to negotiate the meaning of what is contemplated by recognized and affirmed. And there were three of those conferences that took place, and then a fourth one that was finally added. So eventually there were four constitutional conferences, and they, by and large, all broke down Because Aboriginal peoples were saying the first thing to recognize in section 35.1 is to say, for greater certainty, existing Aboriginal and treaty rights includes the right to self-government. And the first ministers of the Canadian state, the premiers and prime minister, couldn't get unanimity on that point. There was, however, two further amendments that came out of this. One was that treaties could be considered to be land claims negotiations. So if there was ever a land claims settlement, that would become a treaty under Section 35.1 of the Constitution. The other amendment to Section 35.1 was that those rights, Aboriginal treaty rights, would apply equally to male and female persons. So there was a gender equality provision that was accepted in the First Minister's conferences, and there was a incorporation of land claims as being treaties under Section 35.1 of the Constitution. But by and large, the main point that Indian, Métis, and Inuit people wanted there was not accepted. And so then you get something called the Meech Lake Accord, which was an attempt by the Mulroney government to bring Quebec into the fold of Confederation, because they likewise had resisted patriation of the Constitution. And they felt the vision of the Constitution wasn't sufficiently respectful of their distinctive place in Confederation as one of the founding peoples of Confederation. And so a package was negotiated to recognize Quebec's distinct status, and Senate reform and Aboriginal rights were put to the side. The patriation formula, though, required a certain kind of alignment of the premiers and the federal government to get the Meech Lake Accord passed. And eventually you get Elijah Harper, an Aboriginal man from northern Manitoba, holding up his eagle feather in the legislative buildings and saying no to Meech Lake, and without Manitoba's permission to affirm or ratify Meech Lake Accord, that amendment died. So Quebec is now further offside because of the Aboriginal issue, and we have no constitutional reform by and large. So the next movement is in 1992, there's something called the Charlottetown Accord, where Quebec's distinct status is dealt with. Senate reform is dealt with. Aboriginal rights are part of that package. And the Aboriginal rights provisions would have said this. This is what was agreed to. The Constitution should be amended to recognize that the Aboriginal peoples of Canada have the inherent right of self-government within Canada. The right should be placed in a new section of the Constitution Act 1982, Section 35.1.1. So we would have had a Section 35.1.1 that would have recognized the right to self-government. The next part of this is the recognition of the inherent right of self-government should be interpreted in light of the recognition of Aboriginal governments as one of the three orders of governments in Canada. And then a contextual statement would have been added to the Constitution as follows. The exercise of the right of self-government includes the authority of duly constituted legislative bodies of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada, each within its own jurisdiction, to A, safeguard and develop their languages, cultures, economies, identities, institutions, traditions, and B, to develop and strengthen their relationships with the lands, waters, environments, so as able to determine and control their development as peoples, according to their own values and priorities, and ensure the integrity of their societies. And then it talks about the role for the courts in this, and then there was to be a five-year delay before this could be judicially interpreted, because it was hoped that further negotiation would flow from the pinning of the right to self-government under Section 35.1.1. Now, the Charlottetown Accord was the product of First Minister's negotiations. So this process 83 to 87 took place in public, in grand conference halls in Ottawa. And so there was a lot of grandstanding that took place there. Positionality, you weren't able to get sort of to the finer detail. Well, these negotiations under the Charlottetown Accord were some of them very public in grand conference halls, but also a lot of dealing between the first ministers, that is the premiers, and the prime minister, and four Aboriginal organizations, the AFN, Native Council of Canada, Métis National Council, and the Inuit organization. We're going to look later about NWAC, the National Women's Association of Canada, and how they wanted to be a part of those negotiations and didn't find their place as a formal part of that table. But the point is, this was a negotiated opportunity for settlement, but then it went out to national referendum and it was defeated. And it's hard to piece out why it was defeated. It might have been the Quebec package, it might have been the Senate reform package, it might have been the Aboriginal package, it could have been varied in different parts of the country. And so you get to the situation in the 1990s, that you've had, you know, years and years of constitutional wrangling, and there is nothing but one section, actually many sections, but section 13, nothing but this, right? The four sections now that are the Aboriginal and treaty rights provisions of the Constitution Act 1982. One thing that's important to say about these provisions is that they are in part two of the Constitution Act 1982. What's part one? That's the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. Aboriginal rights and treaty rights are not part of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. That part one goes from sections 1 to 33. And it's those sections that are subject to the limits clause of section 1 of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. This is a part 2 document. But here we've had all of these years of negotiation. 1990 comes along and the political process has failed to give this any meaning. And so then we're left with the courts to be able to give this meaning, which brings us up to the Sparrow case. But important to, as we pause on the threshold of the Sparrow case, to say it's probably not the best place to work this out through the judicial system. And why should it be there? Why shouldn't it be a product of a more potentially democratic process? Perhaps because minority rights are not always best protected through that back and forth of negotiation. Perhaps you're going to get a better protection in the court process. Perhaps not. And then remembering the point I made earlier, this is not an international forum to be able to deal with these issues. But I want to stop there because I've talked for about half an hour about a long constitutional history, which is very important to start to understand Section 3. If you have any questions or comments or further clarification, yes. Yes.
And was he right? Was he right that he didn't have the jurisdiction, given that the Royal Proclamation and the Constitution Act was with Great Britain and patriation was on the table? I mean, there was potentially an opportunity for those rights to be further solidified?
Yes. So the question has to do with Lord Denning's judgment in 1981, refusing the injunction for the constitutionalization of Aboriginal and treaty rights. And the question is about the correctness of that decision. What if it was the case that Denning was wrong? What if he would have said, this can't be patriated without Aboriginal people's participation? Because there is authority for that point of view. And if he would have taken that, imagine the negotiation that would have had to have occurred there. It would have happened under the spirit of the Royal Proclamation, which is local governments can't usurp Indian affairs. It has to be the more distant government that has the trust-like relationship to watch that the way Indians are relating to local governments is not going to be molesting or disturbing them. Justice, or Lord Denning, is very sympathetic to a lot of those views in the judgment. If you read the judgment, it almost looks like a victory for the Indian Association of Alberta, which is the one that eventually brought the action. But the conclusion doesn't accord with much of his sympathy in the opinion, and therefore, because Great Britain is not there to broker the relationship between Canada and the Indigenous nations, it slides, and Aboriginal peoples are continually fighting to be out from under subordination. Good comment.
So would that mean if Denning had brought the other one in, would it have meant that places like Victoria and Edmonton across the country would not have had jurisdiction over lands?
That's the conclusion, that if Great Britain would have held up the patriation until Aboriginal issues to self-determination were dealt with, then it not only means that Victoria and Edmonton don't have authority in relationship to Indians, it also means Ottawa, as authorities, is constrained. Like all levels of Canadian government would have found themselves having to more fully incorporate the Aboriginal perspectives on the meaning of the rights at stake, as Sparrow's eventually going to say, in any matter dealing with Aboriginal peoples. So that's the stakes here, right? And First Nations lost in that larger constitutional history in terms of being able to get Parliament of Canada, Parliament of Great Britain, United Nations, Court of Appeal of England to take them seriously. But now they're in the Constitution under this fashion, but they're not successful through the negotiations, and so they're now standing before the courts. And there's really been so little jurisprudence in the courts up until 1990. There's a concern about what will occur.
So when you look at that, and you look at the Indian Act and the fiduciary responsibility that falls under the Indian Act.
Yes. So the question is, what is the relationship of the Indian Act and the fiduciary responsibility as accords with the Constitution Act 1982? You could at one level say the Indian Act is a derogation of the Crown and Great Britain's responsibility to Indians. You could also say it's a derogation of Canada's responsibility to Indians, because we're going to talk later about something called Section 88 of the Indian Act, which gives the provincial governments rights to be able to enact laws, as long as they're general laws of application, they apply to Indians. So most provincial laws apply to Indians under Section 88 of the Indian Act, as long as Indians aren't singled out. So the whole Royal Proclamation line of reasoning is check and balance is often eroded through the Indian Act process. Yes.
I'm just curious, because it's Section 35 is in Part 2.
Yes.
What does that mean for a charter application to acts of Indian government?
That's right. So there's a Section 25 of the Constitution. The question is, what does it mean when Section 35.1 is in Part 2? Can the charter rights affect Aboriginal peoples? So in Part 1 of the Constitution Act 1982, the Charter of Rights and Freedoms is a Section 25, which says nothing in this charter, that is nothing in Sections 1 to 33, nothing's in Part 1 of the Constitution Act 1982, shall be interpreted so as to abrogate or derogate any Aboriginal or treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada, or other rights that the Aboriginal peoples of Canada might have. In other words, there's a shielding clause in the Charter that says the Charter shouldn't be interpreted to erode or to derogate, to abrogate Aboriginal and treaty rights. So we're now at the Sparrow case, and what you have here is an ancient maritime tradition that's on the coast of what's now British Columbia, Washington, Oregon, Alaska, where peoples take their living by and large from the sea. And that living is an ancient one, and in accordance with that living, you've got this great civilization, the Salish people. I mentioned there were about 90,000 people when contact was made between Victoria, Puget Sound, Vancouver, and Nanaimo. 90,000 Salish people living in that part of the world. And they had all sorts of sophisticated agreements of trade and commerce, and they had a trade language, Chinook, that enabled them to go back and forth, as I've talked about before. And this movement occurred all around the Salish Sea here. Well, in the 1980s, Ronald Sparrow was out fishing, and he was fishing with a drift net that was 45 fathoms in length. He had a license under the Fisheries Act that enabled him to fish with a drift net that was 25 fathoms in length. So there he was, fishing with technology that was larger than permitted by parliamentary regulation. He's fishing, he brings in his catch, and he's confronted, and he's charged with violating his license, with violating the length of the fishing net that was given to him. And he has a defense. He says, he admits the facts. Yeah, I was fishing with this 45 as opposed to 25 fathom net, but I'm exercising an Aboriginal right here to fish. And this net length restriction is contrary to my Aboriginal right to fish. So where he's fishing here is in a canoe passage, which is on the south arm of the Fraser here below the airport, I think. And he's not the only person from the Musqueam that fishes. The Musqueam Reserve is there at the mouth of the Fraser River, where the UBC campus is. But of course, there's all these other groups that fish up and down the Fraser River. And then of course, there's other groups that fish around the Salish Sea. He's saying Parliament's act is inconsistent with my Aboriginal right. Therefore, Parliament's act, its regulation, is of no force and effect. It has to give way. In other words, my Aboriginal right is higher than any parliamentary law dealing with fisheries. My Aboriginal right constrains Crown sovereignty, he's saying, to be able to restrict my right to engage in a fishery. So that's the issue here. Is the Fisheries Act net length restriction, that regulation there, is that inconsistent with Section 35(1) of the Constitution? And the outcome of the case is, yes, it is. The net length restriction is inconsistent with the Aboriginal and treaty right. The question is then going to be sent back to trial to see whether or not the Parliament can properly infringe Aboriginal and treaty rights, given the test that we're going to be looking at here in a second. But what the case stands for is that Parliament is not supreme in all things when it comes to Aboriginal rights. Then we go through the four different parts of the judgment. If you look at them, they really nicely track the language of the section itself. We're going to be trying to define what is existing, what is an Aboriginal, right? What does it mean to have that recognized and affirmed? Which Justice Lafleury, Justice Dixon are going to be tracking the language of Section 35.1 to try to give us some of that, those meanings. So what does existing mean? We're on page 101 of the materials. And note the first paragraph in the judgment dealing with existing. The word existing makes it clear that the rights to which Section 35.1 applies are those which were in existence when the Constitution Act 1982 came into effect. There's a survival of rights. There's a continuity of things that were there prior to 1982 that are now given greater weight, given supremacy in many respects over provincial and federal law. But then the next sentence. This means that extinguished rights are not revived by the Constitution Act 1982. So there's something of a victory here for Aboriginal peoples, and there's something of a huge loss. Because that one sentence accredits, maybe, hundreds of years of colonialism. If extinguishment is read in a broad way, this means that the Supreme Court of Canada now affirms that extinguishment. If it's somehow been, we're going to look at the test for extinguishment in a minute, if it's somehow been clearly and plainly taken away, this judgment ratifies that extinguishment. It says that was okay prior to 1982. Now that doesn't maybe seem like a very generous reading, maybe it's not the reading that we're often used to, but the stakes are pretty big here if that is a broad power that will be interpreted broadly by the court. But they do say existing in 1982 means not extinguished. There's a positive read on that, which is that if it's not been taken away, it survives. And the question for this case is the Aboriginal fishing right taken away? Has it been extinguished, or does it survive? The court also rejects reading existing as how it was, meaning as how it was regulated at the moment the Constitution Act came into existence. You know, so British Columbia would have its laws dealing with fisheries, and New Brunswick and Nova Scotia would have its different laws dealing with fisheries, and likewise other provinces would have their laws, and the court's saying we're not freezing the regulation of those different provincial regimes. They reject what they call a patchwork quilt idea of Aboriginal rights. Aboriginal rights are not given meaning by their regulation.
So, but fisheries is a federal law.
A federal power that's administered by the provinces. So the provinces, when they pass their laws, it's as if they're federal law there, and the court's not going to freeze that framework into place. Court also says that Aboriginal rights are not to be frozen in their primeval simplicity. In other words, they're allowed to develop through time in a contemporary form. Yes.
So does that mean that they didn't take into consideration how the fisheries would have been customarily regulated? Because we have, you know, very strong customs.
Yes, so they're not taking account of Aboriginal law here in regulating the customs of the fisheries. They're just saying that the way Parliament or the provinces under Parliament's authority regulated the coastal fisheries is not going to be frozen in place.
So the fact that they didn't acknowledge Aboriginal ways of doing fisheries, did that just mean automatically they didn't exist, or is it part of the not extinguished?
Yeah, so the fact that the government didn't acknowledge those fisheries as having an Aboriginal customary regulation is actually favorable to the Indians here. We're going to see in a second the fishery survives. Yes.
It seems like you see later in like Penmanship 1 over there, where the courts are saying that high stakes gambling didn't happen in the same way, so it wasn't acceptable. Is that kind of like going against what happened to Sparrow, or is that just like Sparrow, when they say it's evolutionary, it's not super evolutionary, and there's like a limit to how it
works? Yeah, we're going to see that this idea that it's evolutionary is going to have some kind of limits on it. They're going to be created by the Vanderbeek case that we're talking about next class. So Pamadouan and Vanderbeek put another gloss on that evolutionary, because here the court actually says these rights are not frozen. So you would have expected, perhaps, Baudry looked at the Pamadouan case, if they're not frozen, why can't you develop high-stakes gambling in the present day if it's not extinguished explicitly by the government? Because they're not to be dealt with as they were regulated in 1982. So this looks like good news by and large to Aboriginal peoples, right? It's a generous, it's a liberal, it's a flexible interpretation, not frozen, evolutionary, not dealt with as the province has dealt with it. Looks really great, and it is great from many perspectives, until you think about that flip side, which is if anything is extinguished before 1982, it can't be touched by the court. They just have to affirm. The court has to affirm that those rights aren't existing as of 1982. Second part of the judgment deals with Aboriginal rights. So we ask, what is existing? Now we're saying, what is an Aboriginal right? What is the nature of the Aboriginal right? What is the scope? How broad might that right be? And the court is quite good, on bottom of page 101 over to page 102, in drawing upon the Musqueam perspective in giving meaning to the right being claimed here to be able to fish. They talk through Dr. Suttles about the salmon not only being an important source of food, but an important part of the beliefs of the Salish people and in their ceremonies. It says the salmon were held to be a race of beings that had, in myth times, established a bond with human beings, requiring the salmon to come each year to give their bodies to the humans, who in turn treated them with respect shown by the performance of proper ritual. So the last couple of classes, I've told you stories about turtles rising out of oceans, and moles talking with other animals and giving rise to constitutional obligations for Aboriginal peoples. Now here's the story of a race of beings, the salmon, that come in the creation times, in the Genesis times, and have kinds of obligations between the parties. And the court says, in understanding the Aboriginal right, we have to take account of those ways of framing the world. And they make the point that what's being demonstrated here is that the Musqueam fish for food, but also for social and further for ceremonial purposes. They leave the question of commercial fishing behind, because it wasn't pleaded in the case. They could have dealt with that issue. A 45-fathom drift net catches a lot of fish. This could have been a commercial right to fish here, but the court at this moment constrains the scope of the right to this. The Vanderbeek case, which we'll talk about next class, will pick up the commercial right to fish. The court also says, when we look at the right to fish here, we see what the Musqueam are doing is something that's integral to their lives, is necessary to their survival. It's a part of their culture. Statement, you then get the nature and the scope of the right. Now, Vanderpeet's going to come along and put a further gloss on this, because the right was not disputed by the Crown here. The Crown didn't take issue with the fact the Musqueam fished for food, social, and ceremonial purposes. So there was not a test to create, there was no test created here to say, what do you need to ask in order to defer, to find the right? There's kind of just, there's an ethos created here. You look to the perspective of the peoples and you take account of their own traditions in define, in understanding the right. But Vanderpeet's going to come back to this nature and scope of the right. The court moves on to reject the idea that the right to fish for food, social, and ceremonial purposes was not extinguished. So my question here is, why is the right to fish for food, social, and ceremonial purposes not extinguished? And the court says the regulation of the right does not equal the extinguishment of the right. So the province was saying, look at the regulations. Since the 1870s, there's been a progressive restriction on what the Indians can do. And when you read this legislation together, it shows that the sovereign here, the federal government acting with the province, the federal government did things that were necessarily inconsistent with the survival of the right to be able to fish for food, social, and ceremonial purposes. With all of this sort of intertwining regulation. And the court says the province is confused. Regulation does not equal extinguishment. At bottom, I'm going to read on page 103, the first full paragraph, the first sentence there. At bottom, the respondent, that is the province's argument, confuses regulation with extinguishment. That the right is controlled in great detail by the regulations does not mean that the right is thereby extinguished. So all that was happening is that Aboriginal peoples were going out from 1867 to 1982, exercising their own rights under progressive provincial regulation. But that progressively restrictive legislation, regulation, did not extinguish those rights. Because what extinguishment requires is clear and plain intent from the Crown. And here, you can't read clear and plain intent from the effect of the law, you know, how it operates in practice. It seems as though something much more explicit is required. Yes?
So even when they outlawed the use of the, what do you call them, the wicker fences and things?
That's right. So even saying you can't use fish weirs on your rivers is just a regulation of a right. It's not an extinguishment of the right, because there was no clear and plain language saying that that was gone. Yes?
How does that interact with sort of all the other sort of, I mean, all the banning of cultural practices with that?
Yes. So, you know, I gave that, so the question is, how does this test interact with the banning of other cultural practices? Does it seem clear that governance was extinguished, right to religious freedoms were extinguished, rights to economic pursuits, rights to education to your children are extinguished? If you look at the effect of the regulation, you would say, that was the intent. That's what Duncan Campbell Scott said, that those, our object is to continue until there's not an Indian problem because there's no more Indians in Canada because they're all extinguished. Question for us, is that just the regulation of a right? Or is that outright obliteration of the right? This court says, the fact that they're regulating in great detail doesn't mean they're extinguished. It's an open question, and that's what we're continuing to fight about.
It could just be that maybe it's more one than the other, but we should just ignore it because it's
Yeah, that's the question. What do we do with that history? Do we turn the page on that horrible restrictive treatment that the First Nations, Métis Inuit, received at the hands of the federal and provincial governments and say that's not extinguishment? Or should we read that more strongly? Say, no, no, that's, I'm sorry, that was terrible, but that's got to take things out of existence. And that, there, that's, there's not a clear answer to that question. It's one of the things that we're still working through.
It just seems sort of strange to me that, 1982 is sort of the cutoff date. So by regulating that something is not allowed, it's almost like admitting that it is a right in existence that would otherwise be practiced.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, if they outlawed something and it wasn't in practice in 1982, then it's not in existence. I mean, has anyone really, is there a right that is now no longer in existence because they outlawed it?
The question is there a right that's no longer in existence because it's been extinguished? And I'm trying to think of a case that said, here's clear and plain extinguishment. I can't think of one. There might be one that comes to someone's mind in this room. But I don't think we've had a final determination where we get an example of here's clear and plain extinguishment. But so much turns on this kind of characterization, right? The fact that it's regulated in great detail does not mean it's extinguished. I wrote my LLM thesis back in 1991. I made an argument that through seven generations, our right to self-governance, our right to self-determination was never extinguished, even though it was controlled in great detail. And I try to show through my own family history, I called it the genealogy of law, how through seven generations, there were certain impositions that greatly impinged on our ability to live freely, but all along, underneath that, was rolling our own Aboriginal rights. The federal government was regulating governance, but just because they were regulating them, it didn't define the governance. This is what the implication of Sparrow is. Regulation of rights doesn't mean extinguishment of rights. Regulations of rights does not mean the definition of the rights. The rights come from a different place.
Could Campbell be seen as affirming that self-government hasn't been extinguished?
Yes.
Even though it's not a Supreme Court case and it's specifically about the NISCA agreement?
Yes. The Campbell case, which we read last class, could be read as affirming the right to self-government. It said it wasn't extinguished, both the inherent right and the right that then's modified into the treaty, and therefore it's recognized and affirmed. In other words, just because the NISCA were regulated under the Indian Act with all those kinds of restrictions I talked about in our second class, didn't take that out of existence.
Does anyone make the argument that extinguishment was kind of contrary to the government's fiduciary duty or something like the acts of extinguishment by the federal government that wasn't legitimate because it was only supposed to be the British Crown doing it anyway and it was delegated, so even if they had, who cares? Because
yeah.
They kind of it was almost like we had a contract and it was kind of made under false pretenses or whatever.
Yeah.
It was counted.
So this is a great question. Has anyone made the argument that extinguishment itself is contrary to the government's own laws, either the fiduciary obligations or the fact that it should have been Great Britain, not Canada, dealing with that? Yes, those arguments have been made. They've not received a lot of sympathetic treatment before the courts at this moment because of the second sentence in that existing paragraph. So what we're left with is the future fight's going to be on two grounds. One, is it even proper that the Sparrow Court ratified hundreds of years of extinguishment? Is that proper? That's one ground for fight. And though people are arguing that, I don't see the courts going to go back to that anytime soon. But the other part is, what constitutes clear and plain intent to be able to extinguish your right? How broadly do you read extinguishment? How do you read it in favor of the federal government? Do you read it in favor of the First Nations government? We've got some possible guidance here. How does Section 35(1) affect parliamentary sovereignty? The court says on the one hand, and now I'm on page 104 of the materials. We're now talking about recognize and affirm. It's about 3 or 4 lines up from the bottom, 5 lines up from the bottom. There was from the outset never any doubt that sovereignty and legislative power, and indeed the underlying titles of such lands, vested in the crown. So when we're talking about section 35.1, what's recognized and affirmed, there's no doubt, the court says, even from the outset, that the crown gets the overarching sovereignty and the underlying title, which wraps First Nations within its jurisdiction and control. But of course we can pause on that, because you've read the Siwi case, you've read the Chippewa of the Sarnia case, you've read the excerpt from the Conley and Woolridge case, you've read the Campbell case, we've talked a little bit about the history. There was from the outset doubt. Maybe not in hindsight, but at the time things were unfolding on the ground, outset there was doubt about where the crown had sovereignty. You know, there was a fight not only between First Nations and the crown, but then the crown's own relations with Great Britain and France and others. Pretty broad statement, but that's the preface to recognition and affirm. Court does note that the Crown has historically neglected Aboriginal peoples. Little reference in law to their rights, even the white paper, which was reporting to override those rights. And they say Section 35.1 therefore provides a much needed recognition. In fact, the court says it changes the rules of the game. They draw from a Professor Lyon who taught at Queen's University. I'm now in the middle of page 108. After recognizing that Section 35.1 represents the culmination of a long and difficult struggle to get those other kinds of sources of law recognized and affirmed. Professor Lyon, quoted by the court here, says, "The context of 1982 is surely enough to tell us that it is not just a codification of the case law on Aboriginal rights that had accumulated by 1982. Section 35 calls for a just settlement for Aboriginal peoples. It renounces the old rules of the game under which the Crown established courts of law and denied those courts the authority to question sovereign claims made by the Crown." So from their beginning statement, you might think, they're just playing the old game. You know, they're recognizing Crown sovereignty, underlying title, but then they come back and say, no, it's not the old game, and in fact, we as courts have the power, the obligation, the authority to question Crown assertions of sovereignty. And so the courts and parliaments must construe Section 35.1 in a way, and I'm drawing up different words, that are found from 106 to 108, which is they have to be purposefully construed. We're going to learn more about the purposes of Section 35.1 when we come to the Vanderpeek case next class, which is the reconciliation purposes. They have to be construed generously for the Indians, liberally for the Indians. They have to be construed in a trust-like way and in a way that is not adversarial as between the government and Aboriginal peoples. So one of the questions we asked a moment ago is how are we going to interpret extinguishment in a future case? If the court stays true to its word, on the one hand, we're going to allow Crown the right to that extinguishment, but when it's exercised, we're going to say Indians need to be given a generous, liberal interpretation, trust-like, not ever. So you strain against, it seems, an interpretation that would be cramped, that would work against Aboriginal people's rights. So the crown sovereignty can be constrained because it incorporates a fiduciary duty. It sanctions challenges to economic and social policy. I'm just drawing from the words of the judgment here. It gives a measure of control over crown conduct. It's a strong check, is another word that's used here, on legislative power. And the government bears the burden of justifying any negative effects on Aboriginal rights. We do have checks and balances in Canadian law. It's not just a U.S. constitutional phenomenon. There's something in the Royal Proclamation that has this vision attached to it. There's something in Section 9124 that has this vision attached to it. Now there's something in what the court is saying, that crown sovereignty is constrained. For these reasons, and this kind of interpretive approach needs to give meaning to Aboriginal and treaty rights when they're recognized and affirmed. The next question then, so following from this, we're talking about recognition and affirmation. We're seeing kind of a, like the Royal Proclamation itself, mixed messages. The Royal Proclamation says, Her Majesty's, this is Her Majesty's dominion, and it's our land. But then they also say, it's Indian land, and it's not going to be taken from them until such time as we create a formal agreement, because we don't want to molest and disturb them. Mixed messages. Well, Sparrow, similar kind of mixed messages here. So we want to ask, why can the government legislate Aboriginal rights in relationship to Aboriginal rights? Particularly when there's no textual permission to be able to do so. So the First Nations here said, the government should not be able to restrict net lengths. They don't have that authority. Once you recognize and affirm an Aboriginal right, government law is of no force and effect. They said that was the argument. That's the end of the story. They said to the government, to the court, you have no Section 1 in Section 35.1 that allows you to create reasonable limits on these rights found in Part 2 of the Constitution. So how does the court say that the government can legislate to restrict Aboriginal rights, given that there's no textual permission to do so, right? There is textual permission to erode or infringe charter rights because of Section 1. There's no kind of similar thing here. And the court says, because the rights are not absolute, that's the reason they can be infringed. Now, there may be a lot of theoretical truth to that idea of rights. But it's kind of interesting as you read how that comes about. It's on the bottom of page 107. You know, they say, the last paragraph, there's no explicit language in the provision which authorizes this court to assess the legitimacy of legislative action. So they admit that. They also say, yet the words recognition and affirmation incorporate a fiduciary relationship. In other words, in fact, there's further restrictions placed on the government there, and they're therefore so important some restraint on the exercise of sovereign power, so far so good for the Indians. But then the next sentence comes along that doesn't seem to be related to the prior sentence. Rights that are recognized and affirmed are not absolute. Federal legislative powers continue, including, of course, the right to legislate with respect to Indians pursuant to 9124 of the Constitution Act. Section 35.1 is now read together with 9124 to say that federal power has to be reconciled with federal duty. So, the Crown can infringe Aboriginal rights, because rights aren't absolute. Now, there might be a, how do we know when infringement has occurred? Well, Aboriginal groups can stand up and, through their perspective, say, here's an unreasonable limitation on my right through government action, or something the government is doing is causing undue hardship, or the government is denying the preferred means of me exercising this right. It's and notice the word or between them. You don't have to establish all three of those things. You just have to establish one of those blocks. And if the Aboriginal group, from their perspective, is able to show the court it's unreasonable, it's causing hardship, it's denying them the preferred means, then there's been an infringement on the right. Now, that looks great, but note that that gives the government a kick at the can. They might say, this isn't prima facie infringement, because it's not actually denying you your right. It's not really causing you hardship. It's not really unreasonable. So look, it looks great, and it is great from one perspective for Aboriginal peoples, but on another perspective, it's another place where the sovereign can come in and say, well, what we did to you there actually doesn't rise to that standard. We're disputing your perspective, your subjectivity on that front. So how can Parliament justify infringement if you've shown, if Aboriginal people show there's a prima facie infringement? Yes?
So this is just a fully objective standard?
So it seems to be a subjective standard from the, so what the First Nations think or Métis or Inuit think, then that's a prima facie infringement. But because the Crown gets to come back and say, we don't agree with your perspective, maybe it's kind of like a modified subjective-objective test there to come up with the test for extinguishment, sorry, infringement. That's a slip, right, that maybe has some significance. Maybe in some cases infringement amounts to extinguishment if the court is satisfied by the government that there's a valid legislative objective that's being pursued by the government, in this case conservation or protection against harm, or the honor of the Crown is being preserved. In this case, if Aboriginal peoples are given priority to the fish for food, social and ceremonial purposes, the law will survive. If the government infringes as little as possible on the right, the law will survive. If Aboriginal peoples are compensated, if there's something that's taken away in the regulation of that right, or if there's a kind of a consultation in dealing with that right. Now this looks great because it allows for negotiation. We'll see a negotiation paradigm being set up now between the provincial government or the federal government and First Nations. But it could also be troubling from another perspective. I said this is outside of the charter, so we shouldn't think of these as charter rights. Obviously, this though looks like charter rights because what you've got is a Section 1-like analysis suddenly being in place. And so this, as I mentioned, was sent back to the trial to be able to ask the question as to whether or not the fisheries regulations justifiably infringed the Aboriginal right. And then they never went back to trial. They negotiated something called the Aboriginal Fisheries Strategy. And under that Aboriginal Fisheries Strategy, they tried to create room for Aboriginal peoples to fish for food, social, and ceremonial purposes. It's not a constitutionalized agreement. And it keeps getting changed from time to time through the years. But right now we're dealing with this field. Yes, the Musqueam have the constitutional protection, but the rest of the people up and down the Fraser River are kind of operating more under policy with the perhaps hope that they would have that broader protection. So I've put the last slide here just all in one place to help you remember that we're dealing with the key words in Section 35.1. The existing Aboriginal right recognized and affirmed. In the Vanderbeek and Gladstone case, there's going to be more definition of Aboriginal right. That's next class. In the next class, we're going to see further layers being added to what the government might do under a valid legislative objective or in accordance with the honor that they have as the Crown. And that's it. I'll happy to entertain questions for a moment or so. And and we'll come back Wednesday.